All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. You are watching the LPL in English. We're joined here in the Twitch TV studios. I mean, this is awesome in San Francisco, California, but we've got, before we get into the games, a preview show for you. So, Froskrin, will you like to take a little bit away about the, maybe why our newer viewers might want to watch the LPL?
And so, obviously, we're in the midst of the final, so we decided to do this little preview show, just like Pyra said, kind of break it down for our newer viewers. So, why watch LPL? And I feel like it really breaks down into kind of three different facts. Variety, speed, and team fighting. Variety or creative picks, I feel like globally, the rest of the world has kind of subscribed to this almost pseudo-Korean playstyle where it trickles down to the other nations. Other regions.
Regions, nations. Well, you know, some of them are nations in and of themselves.
Exactly. LPL kind of subscribes to a different mentality. You do see some of those Korean influences kind of bleeding through, but it's a lot more creative. It's a lot more random. You have
different,
more unique
very
picks. I know what Renekton mid, Veigar mid.
Well, okay, let's not all discount. Just these are picks that, you know, Zatai would like to pick up from time to time. The mid laner on
the
Invictus game. That is absolute insanity. But let's talk a little bit about specifically that first point you mentioned. The crazy variety, the micro metas that come into play. Every team has a signature style that is very much them, and it's not like they're all trying to do what they think the best Koreans do. They definitely play something that is into their own tune.
Yes, we have pick map pressure based teams. We have team fight late game based teams. We have the typical pseudo hyper aggressive Chinese teams, Invictus Gaming,
Starhorn Royal Club as well.
Starhorn Royal Cup is a perfect example. So it's a lot more flavor and a lot more versatility.
Absolutely. And of course, that's not really all there is to it. There's a lot more that we could get into, especially, you know, if you want to open the can of worms that is Invictus Gaming. But we'll talk about them maybe a little bit later. Another thing to note is the game times are so much shorter. There's, I think, a stat up there about how the average LPL game length, or some of them are
it
like...
It's the longest average North American game length. Or no, the average North
American average
is
the longest
LPL average.
These guys, they turn up the pressure quick.
There's no such thing as a 30-minute game and 4 kills on the board.
Unless there's like 5 Barons involved.
Unless there's 5 Barons.
I don't think the math actually works for that, but you know, it's something that would be possible there.
They've been the rules in China.
Oh yeah, pretty crazy. Speaking of Barons, I mean, that's something that a lot of teams fixate on. There has been that historical downfall of, I mean, you guys have seen your Baron throws, of course, any number of them, but it's just crazy. And this is the region that invented the 4VO push. They have a number of novel strategies that they have crafted for that early game dominance and kind of tend to just beat you down in lane. But let's talk about something that everybody definitely wants to know about, the team fighting in China. That is what we live for. Those are those massive highlights. This is really what it's all about. Frost, you want to break that one down?
And I think it transitions really well from kind of the speed context. It's a very fast-paced game, and this really caters and carries over into how they do their team fighting. I mean, when you think of how a team fight breaks down a League of Legends, it's almost kind of this front-to-back mentality of just going through a composition and working your way back. Chinese teams, it's not just being able to do the front-to-back. It's flanking. It's coming from the different sides. It's being very, again, creative about the picks, the compositions, bringing those hard engage tools, stacking and aligning your abilities perfectly to make the most devastating impact. It's very fun to watch, and definitely what the region is probably best well known for.
Absolutely. You know, there's another like little quirks that kind of go along with that too, because of the proficiency of team fighting, because of how many kills and deaths we tend to see. Sometimes that might be mistaken for maybe a sloppy play if you're not familiar with it, but there's also so many unique little niche strategies that they come up with. It. A lot of supports, for example, AP supports, they'll build a Medjay Soulstealer, not because they're trying to BM the enemy team. It's because when you've got so many kills and assists so early into the game, it's a legitimate item.
Yeah, we do see a lot more of those stacking items in the LPL. It's the word is reactionary. It is a very reactionary playstyle. People will see, this looks really sloppy, it doesn't look controlled. It's all about being proactive and reactive and just how that draws out. There's not just that one concentrated team fight. It's a very, you know, 45 seconds of a team fight all over the map. Movement speed is very important to these teams.
Oh, incredible mobility. The pick comps have been, in particular, something that has kind of taken off, but also jungle pressure kind of being on an up and down in terms of, you know, where they actually focus that pressure. We'll talk a little bit more about the matchup tonight and how that relates to it as well. But specifically, there's our two teams. We have OMG taking on Edward Gaming. These two teams have a very, very storied set of past, very different histories. And let's go a little bit into detail about them and where they come from, where are they going?
I think we can probably start with OMG just because they're one of the longer standing teams as far as the LPL. Original founding member, Go Going and Drug.
Yeah. Very, very... How do we put it? He's been around for a long time. As long as the LPL's been around, we've had a number of other players that have been around. Of course, EDG is a lot newer, and they are kind of that superstar team. But, you know, I think we might have to cut this one a little bit short since we're actually going to get started pretty soon.
I know. We're getting feedback from our producers through our ears like, okay, guys, the teams are getting ready. They're ready to clash.
They're ready to go. I think they're pretty excited. So that's about all we're going to have the time for on the preview show. I hope you guys have enjoyed it, and don't go anywhere. We'll be back in just a moment. We're going to be bringing you the LPL Finals. I, for one, cannot wait. My goodness, that's one of the teams we're going to be watching tonight. Welcome everybody to the LPL. We're going to be bringing you the finals. Well, we're casting this one live from the Twitch TV studios in San Francisco. I am Devin, Pyrotechnics Young, joined on the broadcast by Ryan Frosker and more. It's so good to see you in person.
Pyro, we are in San Francisco right now. How crazy is that?
It's pretty awesome. Of course, we're going to be casting an event that's a little bit further across the pond over in China. That's going to be an insane final set. OMG, EDG, they're fated to clash, it seems, as they've already played once before. Of course, EDG getting the better set of that.
Just a couple of logistics going into this. Now, EDG, because they have never fallen into the loser's bracket. Now, for those who didn't follow the playoff series, it is a double elimination. EDG was never locked into that lower bracket, which means that going into this set, they have a one-game advantage, which means that it's 2-0 for set match world ticket for EDG.
And, of course, that's a little bit troubling for OMG, as they have been playing kind of on the back foot for most of these playoffs. They have taken games with Starhorn Royal Club all the way to game number 5, both times they played them and defeating them. But of course, they lost with only taking one game off of Edward Gaming the last time these two met. But that was the only game that EDG has actually lost this entire playoff set.
So, like you said, it effectively comes back to OMG playing from the back foot. Are they able to pick it up? Because they don't have as many chances as they would normally have. That said, their games last night against Starhorn Royal Club, explosive.
Absolutely crazy. And of course, games with Starhorn, you have to expect that to be, but OMG has been showing that they are a team of true versatility, one that can be incredibly potent under pressure. EDG plays one style, plays it extremely well, but OMG, they are the kings of adaptation. Can they do it? Can they turn this one around? Or will it be the spring and the summer and EDG going to Worlds for first seed?
Now, if EDG does not win this best of 5, it immediately goes into a best of 3 between OMG and EDG. The loser or winner of that, or the loser drops into the regional tournament. The winner goes on to Worlds for China.
Exactly. Of course, that regional tournament containing all the teams that are in these playoffs, plus Invictus Gaming, who took the second place spot at the spring finals. And yeah, I mean, that'll be absolutely excellent. But these guys don't want second place. These guys want blood. And now OMG will have to find the higher road to take. If they can win this one, they will have to win out 3 games and only drop one. They can only afford to lose one. I mean, that may be saying a lot against a team like Edward Gaming. I mean, these guys, they might be a little one-dimensional, but they will grind you into the dust if you let them get to the point they want to be at.
And you absolutely said it. It's adaptability. OMG, they don't have the running room to warm up to that. They have to come out of the gate ready. And frankly, it should be relatively easy to figure out what Edward Gaming want to do. They're a 5v5 team fighting team. I believe that Clear Love has the highest kill participation of any player in the LPL. That's a 77%. And 4 of their members on their team all have kill participations over 70%. What that statistic breaks down to is that when EDG do something, they do it together. It's very much about surviving the lane phase, getting to late game, waiting for that 35-minute missed Baron call, taking one fight and winning the game.
Absolutely. But OMG, they like to take the fight early if they can. Maybe not the entire 5v5, but they will certainly skirmish you if they think it will give them an advantage. While their bot lane may not be considered the strongest in the LPL, they have had a little bit of help, infusion, a little bit of medicine. You might call him Drug, also known as Alan or Loveland. He has come up with some absolutely massive plays, and this is a guy, well, he'll just murder you in your own jungle if he gets the chance.
And it's effectively using Drug, but also pairing him up with the other Bash Bros, as we like to call them, going OMG's top laner and their all-star mid laner Cool. I'm sure everyone's heard of their Yasuo play. That was a 610 gold per minute.
Yeah, he broke a lot of records and actually took the record away from Son on the gold per minute. But coincidentally, we haven't really seen much Yasuo because it has been banned away from him. Expect that to definitely be a focus tonight. EDG doesn't mess around when it comes to picks and bans. And you know, for a region that some say maybe doesn't have the strongest pick ban phase, they're certainly showing that they lead in that department.
It's also very hard to ban these teams just because they are so versatile and huge in their champion.
All right, well, and we're getting ready to go into the first game, guys. Looks like it is going to be game number 1. I guess you could call it game number 2 if you give that first game over to EDG. But let's talk about the players. You've got on EDG side, in the top lane is, of course, going to be Koro. He is, you know, was known as that supportive style player for a long time. As you can see from his recent champions and his most played throughout the season, that's definitely changing. This guy is kind of growing into a mini-go going of sorts.
And it's funny that you say that Koro was very recognized for his Shyvana, his Trundle play, but as you can see, his top 3 play this split, Kayle, Aurelia, and Jax, really kind of transitioning, which was very nice to see about EDG.
Mm-hmm, of course, and then prowling the jungle for EDG is going to be Clear Love. He has had success on a multitude of champions. Jarvan and Lee Sin have been some of his favorites. But of course, Clear Love is definitely going to be a jungler of many strengths, many traits. That 77% kill participation for a guy who doesn't gank, that means something.
It's about trying to get that guy to gank, and of course we're seeing his champion pool start to trend that way to get more involved with this team.
Absolutely, and then of course in the mid lane it will be Yu, short for unstoppable, and that's what he has been a number of levels, but he does play the more utility style mages. I think they've fallen back into that style. They put him on some assassins for a while that he preferred to play. Zed, for example, didn't quite work out well for the team, so they have kind of moved him back to that role of being a little more support-based, but it has certainly worked out for the late game.
Yu is the crutch on which EDG sits, but let's talk about their superstar. It's going to be Name, the AD carry, possibly the best AD carry in the world, and has found it on those hyper carries. We do see Lucian in the mix there, but a lot of Kog'Maw, a lot of Twitch. This is a guy that you cannot touch, even on very low mobility champions like Kog'Maw, able to sidestep those Jarvan ults, those Gragas casts, thing like that.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a reason they call him Devil, but of course, every Devil has to have an Angel in the lane with him. It's going to be FCCF, the support. And this guy has shown incredible variety. He's one of the top tier LPL supports. And in a region that prizes ADCs, the protection rate, that's something absolutely huge. He has come up huge recently on Janna particularly, but he's also rocked Braum and Leona. Very safe, but at the same time, kind of all-in champions. Name loves getting kills, and this guy will enable it.
Spoon feeding. I love to see that Janna pick slip in there. And it was pretty much on the back split. I think he had all four of his Janna games.
He almost won. It was almost 100% win rate until they did drop that one game. But yeah, of course, that is it for Edward Gaming. Their opponents tonight, it will be OMG. Let's get the top laner up on the screen. It's going to be Go going, and he does get going. He gets some massive stats in that 1v1. He will take anyone on.
He goes, but we do see a lot of overlapping champions in that most played category, Kayle and Aurelia. Expect Aurelia to be a very hotly contested pick, as well as Maokai.
Mm-hmm. We have seen a lot of bans focused on the top lane, especially of Go going. They actually have taken steps to ban away an Alistar play that he has had some success on as well. And of course, in the jungle, it will be everyone's favorite bit of medicine drug. Alan Loveland, whatever you prefer to call him, he has come up massive for his team. And expect him to do it again.
And exactly the same champions that Clearlove is playing.
Mm-hmm. That's another hotly contested point.
Jarvan is always going to be popular in LPL due to its ability to engage teamfights. But the proficiency of Lee Sin and its mechanics in China cannot be understated. It is amazing to watch these guys get Lee Sin.
Oh, yeah. Everybody. I mean, we always talk about the insect kicks. Of course, insect being now on Starhorn Royal.
Cacao!
You can call it cacao kicks if you want now. I mean, that was some pretty awesome play out of KT Arrows. But nonetheless, it's pretty nuts. In the mid lane, of course, this guy, well, he's one cool mid laner, and he is absolutely phenomenal. Puts on his carry pants, and he puts them on hard. That Yasuo play, just the tip of the iceberg. This guy can do anything.
And that was only one Yasuo game. Most played, Ryze, Twisted Fate, and Ziggs. This is Messiah in Second Coming. It's going to be cool. One of the few professional players to come back after, you know, effectively, quote-unquote, retiring. He was injured because of his eyes, took that short break off the scene, came back, and is as explosive as ever.
Yep, definitely on the up and up. And this is a guy who has been able to go up 1v1 against some of the best mid laners in the world, with Fakers, of course, and Dade. But, you know, he's not the entirety of the team. There are still more to go in the AD carry role. Considered maybe not the strongest link in the chain, it will be Sahn. But he has recently really stepped up big time. He likes to hang back, do the damage he needs to in the team fights, and just hope he doesn't get noticed. But when he does, he really steps up big for his team, and it shows in his champion picks especially.
And I think you're absolutely right. He is more of a supportive style AD carry, which kind of sounds weird coming out of China, but Sahn is survive lane phase, come out into the team fight, which is why you see a lot of hyper carries. Twitch, Corki, also big picks for him. Lucian scraped in due to his success at the beginning of the season.
Well, and Lucian's kind of found a lot of play despite some of his changes as well. A little bit odd, but of course,
proficiency in the mobility there.
Yep, and then in the support lane, there have been a few last-minute switch-ups, and of course, you can't see his face. It is Dada7. He's also known as Tricky Boy, Neymar, Koma. Take your pick on that one. He was replacing Cloud, who was benched earlier for some, how would we say it? It kind of didn't really mesh with the team morale. They definitely said it was bringing him down. And Dada has had definite mixed success, but none more so than on Thresh. He's actually drawn bans from it.
Well, it's almost come down to he plays two champions. He plays Thresh or he plays Braum. He has a bit of an issue of getting caught out and feeding some early kills, but that started to even out when they put him on the tankier champions.
Yeah, definitely Braum and Leona coming up pretty big for him in those plays, but that is, of course, our lineups for tonight. OMG and EDG, it will be a best of five series to determine who wins the summer championship. And, well, guys, It's hard to say who's going to take this one. You might call EDG the favorites. They are going to be one game in the lead automatically due to the winner's bracket finish, but you never know. OMG is not a team you can count out.
And OMG historically doesn't lose the second game in their best of series. So, I mean, effectively, this is technically the first game for them.
This is still the second game. If they put on that mindset, they can go to it. I mean, they are the kings of adaptation. These are guys that just kind of look at what happened and say, how do we fix that? And they just instantly fix it. It clicks. It's amazing. They're trendsetters in that.
And these are also the top two teams, so they have quite a bit of experience with each other. Again, the veteran status of all of these players. Name alone, this is his, third consecutive playoff run as a player?
And if he wins it, too, I mean, that would be absolutely huge. Again, EDG, I would say that they're a team that they still have a lot to prove, but they're already, if not one of the best teams in China, they've made the statement, if not the best, one of the best, they've made the statement that they will absolutely blaze a trail into Worlds. And if they get the automatic qualifier tonight, that'll kind of really silence the critics once and for all.
It'll also set the stage for what is sure to be an explosive Worlds.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely amazing.
But I wanted to break this down to you, Pyra, because we've talked about, kind of the strengths of the team. And I think you brought up something that was very important kind of pregame. You talked about how OMG and EDG, they really fit together like a puzzle and their strengths and weaknesses.
Yeah, in the lineups especially, you look at the way that they're traditionally kind of laid out. EDG, definitely a powerhouse team, but more of like a traditional Chinese team in the sense that they prioritize the AD carry. They have a very strong supporting backbone in FCZF. However, their top lane and their mid lane are kind of fallback. Okoro, until recently, played a much more supporting style, and he might fall back on that again. They have shown that under pressure, they kind of revert to an older style to a lot of success. Yu is very evident in that, in a lot of his choices of Ziggs and Orianna in particular. And their jungler, he doesn't gank because he trusts that his lanes will do, if not maybe winning, they will do okay.
He doesn't gank.
And he has been changing that a little bit. So, this is a team that's kind of in flux. But nonetheless, you look at that puzzle where the ADC and the support are very strong and the top and mid not so much. Exactly the opposite story on OMG. Gogoing is an absolutely fantastic. He's a monster top laner. He'll go toe-to-toe with anyone if you give him the chance. And honestly, the only way people have been able to shut him down is in like a 3v1.
We've seen a lot of targeted bans actually going up into the top lane to try to slow Gogoing down. Again, this is a region that prioritizes the AD carry, diving that back line. And so when you have a top laner that is as terrifying as Gogoing, he's that 1v1 PDD mentality, you have to come up and deal with me, versus it kind of a utility style top laner like Koro. It's very important to focus him out. So I believe we are going into champ select, so we'll see what the bans... Oh, there's that Yasuo ban.
Immediately. You have to respect that. Cool might have only played it once, but he had such a monster record on it that it is just almost necessarily ban away, and they don't even want to mess around with it. So EDG will get that one off the table right away. Expect the Maokai. I think OMG doesn't have to focus it. They will ban away, use Ziggs, and that, I think it's a pretty reasonable choice.
Oh, yes. He's a monster on Ziggs. Just dunks on everyone. Braum being a taken away from Dada 7, so...
Kind of the key to the game, really, though. Like, don't let Dada get on a comfort champion, because we've seen him fall apart when he's not.
Well, you said it yourself. OMG's weakness is in that bottom lane. That is the weak chain. Do that to Synergy, or just because Son is naturally one of the weaker members on a team full of all-stars like OMG has, but targeting there is a surefire way. Again, expect it. Ooh, wow,
the Kog'Maw
target ban on Name.
I think that's really curious, because we haven't seen a ton of Kog'Maw has been a very contested pick, but there aren't a lot of ADC bans.
That tells me that they're going to probably go for a Tristana.
Mm.
Or they might... Well, to ban out a hyper carry like that, Son does play Tristana a lot more than some of the other... And if OMG wants to go toe-to-toe with EDG's late game, that would make sense to me.
Okay, I think I could see that. But yeah, really a little bit different than we've already seen, and this is the genius of OMG. They mix it up so frequently. Orianna now banned away, so the mid lane is actually getting very shallow. We'll have to see if they go for the first pickups. Thresh is still on the table if they want to try and take that one away from Dada, but he has been good on Leona. We'll have to see what the last ban OMG spends is.
I'm kind of curious about the bans on mid lane. Yes, it is very important to take away a powerhouse like Yasuo. Again, cannot emphasize that enough. He got one game on the champion, and he went 20-1, 610 gold per minute. That said, in his series against Starhorn Royal Club, I believe he played five different champions.
Oh, yeah.
For
we
the
didn't
entire
talk
thing.
About this. He has a monster champion pool, and there is the Thresh ban away. So that means Maokai available, instantly picked up by Koro. But you know what? Gogoing's got quite a lot in his arsenal, and he will immediately lock in the Alistar pick.
The one thing that I will say about this, though, is that Maokai, Alistar, definitely fit Toro's playstyle more so than Gogoing's. Again,
that's true.
He's the Lord Flame, he's the Zion Spartan, he's the PDD type of
He wants to hard carry. I think Gogoing might have had a little bit more luck on Aurelia, but it has been troublesome to 1v1 as that against champion like Maokai. Of course, we are on 4.14. This is a patch that is... He has received a few nerfs. He's had a few leaves cut off, if you will.
most notably, his ultimate has been capped at 10 seconds. But also, Drug, picking up the Lucian here. So they banned the hyper carry, which means that effectively your hyper carries late game are now going to be Vayne, Tristana, Jinx.
Which, of course, Name could easily go for.
Exactly, but this opens up a champion to help kind of carry Somm through his weak laning phase. On the other side, it's going to be FCZF locking in his Morgana, his most played champion of the spring split.
Mm-hmm. And, of course, we do see, aside from Morgana going down, Yu looking like he's going to be picking up the Zilean. Now, this is something that has been bouncing around for a while. It was actually popularized originally by Zatai way back in Season 2, and then, of course, he made a revival of it. Baker picked it up, and, you know, the rest is history.
A chrono shift, if you will.
He went back in time.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's kind of funny how Zilean does that. But he has, I think, mixed success on it, but, you know, you can't count Yu out. If he can stall you, he will.
Well, they really brought it out when they actually came into playoffs. They brought it out in conjunction with Kayle, so you had a Kayle-Zilean composition that worked really well for them, and you started to see target bans against it. This time, of course, it goes through, so automatically EDG are going to carry that through, and there's the Evelynn pick. Of course, we didn't see that in Clearlove's most played this split, but it is a big comfort champion for him.
Yeah, fallback, definitely. And interesting that they're hovering the Ezreal. I don't think that they'll go for this, but Name certainly can hard carry with it. I mean, it would be actually really crazy. I would love that. Yeah, okay, switching over to Corki. That has been kind of the de facto go-to for a lot of champions, although you almost would see these mixed up in a lot of cases. Lucian definitely, you know, would go over to Name, or even Uzi if we were watching a Starhorn game. And then, of course, Son prioritizing a champion that high mobility like Corki.
But we do see the Fizz hover from Cool here.
This would be interesting. Oh, no, he goes for the Cinderlocken. Okay, so definitely thinking about what he wanted to do. There was a lot on the table. We know that he had kind of a back pocket Ahri, but hasn't been as successful as we might have expected.
He's going for the... So typically the idea is that when you're facing an AoE clear mid, like an Orianna, like a Ziggs, like a Zilean, if you don't ban them away... They just infinitely clear and they keep you pushing to your tower. So you pick up an assassin or a 1v1 mid laner and you just kill them. The issue is that Zilean, of course, has his chrono shift. So it's almost like a direct counter. But that's Cool effectively saying, I'm going to 1v2 you and your jungler.
Yeah, I think it's hard to say, but I definitely like the pickups on EDG a little bit better. It's focusing for that late game that they love so much. Zilean is... always kind of a crazy wild card in that regard, and they spent a lot of resources on taking away from the comfort picks of OMG and what they thought they might do. And the answer back seems a bit haphazard.
I think you're exactly right. It was very much in EDG's MO as far as being that late game team fighting comp. Again, you think you have Corki, Maokai, Zilean, things like that. On the other side, though, OMG spreading out their power resources. You have the early game advantage from Son. You have the crazy damage from Syndra, a huge Chinese pick. Gogoing taking up the Alistar as an answer to that Maokai, but we are on the Rift now for game one.
Oh my goodness, it's going to be awesome. And I don't know how many times I'll probably have to end up repeating that phrase, but EDG holding one lead, 1 point lead, one game lead, whatever you want to refer to it as. So they only have to win two to progress to that automatic Worlds qualifier. But OMG fighting a bit of an uphill battle. Let's see if they can find some success. See if Gogoing and Cool can pull out all the stops. Interesting to see how this combination works. You know, because Gogoing is running an Alistar, they could do something really crazy, like swap him down to bot with Son, and then have kind of Dada just roam around and try to make some plays. We'll see if they can do that as the pause comes in to start the game off.
Well, typically you would want to lane swap the Alistar. The Maokai Alistar 1v1 isn't as terrible. But it's about kind of supporting the roam from Alistar, because that's where he's really powerful.
Absolutely. Of course, if left unchecked, Korra can still do some serious damage, and he might as well just roam as well. Do you think we'll see a lane swap situation coming in? So far, it doesn't look like it, but you never know with these two teams.
Name is not the type of player to look for a lane swap. He's that, I'm going to be the next Wei Xiao. I can be better than that guy. I'm going to 1v1 him. Son, on the other hand, OMG has been very flexible in the different strategies that they've kind of taken up to cater and to hold the hand of their bot lane. B be that a lane swap, be that playing incredibly passive aggressive and very far back off the line. We'll see how the Nami pick works for them working a sustain lane.
Oh man, I almost forgot. There's a Nami in a game with Name. That's always difficult to talk about.
Nami and Name.
At least they're not on the same champion. When ADC Nami becomes a thing, that will be something to be feared. But we see a little bit of shots from the crowd. They're definitely excited to see these two teams. A lot of love for both of them. And you really gotta love the amount of passion that you see out of the fans. A lot of the pregame stuff usually shows them just completely flipping out. It's wonderful to see, really.
My favorite was the Conan sign.
Where
she
proposed?
She was almost like in a wedding dress with like, it was almost Beatles-esque, like Conan coming off the stage, of course, World Elite, and everyone screaming, oh, World Elite, please! No, yeah. It's me, senpai.
No, that was a pretty cool thing. And, you know, of course, the World Elite fans, absolutely huge fan base. You know, you can call them the TSM of China, in a sense. And they
times that by a thousand.
Well, yeah, there we go. Okay, so we're back in the game. A little bit of latency issues, but that's all right as we are getting ready for this game to start. So, line of scrimmage, nothing completely unusual here. Of course, if we expect somebody to make the first move in terms of, you know, out of the jungle and into your face, it's probably going to be OMG.
Typically, they are the more aggressive team going into this. EDG is much more, again, about just surviving the lane phase. Of course, you have, you know, Name can overcome that, be the hyper-aggressive, find the snowball there. But again, Clearlove, not really well known for his ganking. We started to see that trend a little bit as they came up into playoffs. And of course, at the beginning of the split, sometimes he's just incredibly on. But for the most part, a very farm-heavy style jungler, which is why Eve really works out for him.
It seems to me that EDG is a team that kind of like, they will test a lot of waters. They will push the envelope. And if they find that they don't meet resistance, they go out and experiment. They will start ganking a lot. They will do a lot of crazy things. But if they meet stiff competition, like they almost will certainly against OMG, they always fall back into that old habit of let's wait for the late game, let's get it going, and it almost always works.
It's in Chinese League of Legends, it's always who is the more proactive team, because all of these teams are incredibly good at being reactive. Again, it's a very team fight heavy region, so if you give them that advantage, if you draw it out, both teams are going to be able to do that. But it's who's going to dictate the pace of the game. And I feel like Drug, OMG's jungler, definitely has the advantage here. Of course, yeah. Nami taking a bit of early
San,
poke.
San, yeah. We talked all about, of course, San's going to have a little bit better of an early game on Lucian anyways. He has shown incredible proficiency on that champion. But as the game does get underway and there's just a lot of poking out going on, let's talk a little bit more about how Vision has evolved in China. This has been a point of contention. A lot of criticisms have been leveled at the entire region for having a very weak Vision game. It was all about denial and control. But we're starting to see it really change for the better.
It is very apparent that the Chinese teams were watching the OGN finals.
Oh, absolutely.
We've seen very, very similar Vision styles. A lot of sweepers coming in early, a lot of pinks coming out for prepping Dragon, prepping Baron. The issue, though, is it's still kind of carrying out, like, we know we're supposed to be around, you know, Baron or Dragon. We know we're supposed to be here for this objective, but we can't quite figure out how to smooth that out. But definitely there has been an evolution of Vision, but more so Vision denial.
Yeah, and it's coming out in the way that they're able to orchestrate the team fights as well. So pretty normal start. 2v2 bot lane, that is what we've been seeing a lot more of, and no crazy shenanigans as the junglers will take their initial buffs. Actually, though, because of the early game movement from Drug, he's a little bit behind.
Well, also, OMG knows that EDG leashed Red, so they have an idea on which side of the map Eve will be when she has her double buffs around that 3 minute 330 mark.
Very useful when you're dealing with an invisible enemy.
And the last time that really burned OMG because Insect was able to get the invade off. Not this time, of course. Everyone going to stay in their own jungle.
I think EDG is a much more cautious team with a much more cautious jungler in general. Now, a little bit of poke traded out. Name actually faring the worst of it so far in FCZF. This is one of the squishier champions he plays, but the entire bot lane is very low health in general. I wouldn't be surprised if the junglers trend their attention that way. Drug, once he's got his buffs up, can make big plays on this Elise.
The issue is that EDG kind of sacrificed their wave control by leashing, and so they gave the early A lane pressure and experience to OMG, and they have, it's almost like a pseudo poke sustain comp with that Nami Lucian. That's going to be a tough thing. So now that San and Dada have control of this lane, which again, OMG recognizing where are we weak, it's in the bottom lane. I'm going to take off as much pressure as possible, and I'm actually going to start my you know, top side jungle as opposed to the bot side, so they don't have to leash, so they can get, you know, the bonus.
Nice little move by Go-Going as he gets Koro into tower range, able to get out of that quite easily, but Sahn is actually bullying out Name very effectively, and as long as he doesn't get too caught up on one of those dark bindings, he should be okay. It seems like he's really been brushing up on his lane bully tactics. To see Name get pushed back so hard, even against a Lucian, who's going to be a stronger early game champion in general, it's almost like a reversal of what we saw in the last set, where Sahn was just like trying to play it as safe as possible.
And again, it comes back to Drug making the read. You guys don't have to leash to me. You can get the advantage in your lane. And good job by Dada and Sahn to take full advantage of that and to keep Name pushed back. But we do see Clear Love looking for a gank, possibly.
Just waiting around in the lane, Sahn.
No,
go too far forward.
Down.
Yeah, he might actually find this out. That's going to be in the tribe rush. It will be the jungle fight commencing. Drug is a little bit low, but he gets the cocoon off and Clear Love on the chase. Darkbind narrowly misses. Wow, look at those two steps. Good thing he's got eight legs, huh?
Didn't necessarily want to walk into that one, but he does skitter away back to his own jungle. So far, everything's pretty calm. Mm-hmm.
And these are two teams that won't give up first blood easily either. I mean, they don't make moves for no reason. You'll sometimes see, like, almost unwarranted aggression because somebody wants to secure that first blood, you know, getting a little red in the eyes there, just trying to make a play happen. These two teams, not really that style of play.
Should be a bit more patient, although they can definitely turn it on when it comes to diving towers.
Now, speaking of Bash Bros, we were talking about that earlier, but Koro has been coming up and up on the Bruiser page, and he's really giving Go-Going a run for his money, but he's got to be careful. He's really low here, and if, well, Drug's not there, they don't have a whole lot of vision in this game, and actually, right now, there are no wards on the map for EDG. Well, just one. Hanging out that over close to the Dragon Pit, but, I mean, it's regressed a little bit. You can tell since it's still very early in the laning phase, but they're not.
Well, they just have their trinkets available to them. The junglers have made their first back, and on the first back, you do see Drug picked up a pink ward. So again, it's about what he's going to do with that.
How does Sahn keep dodging that? It's not just his relentless pursuit. I mean, we didn't talk about mechanics as much. We kind of downplayed it a little bit. I mean, Name is that guy that is known as, he doesn't have to have mobility champs, and he looks like he's playing on mobility champs with the way he dodges sidesteps, but I guess we'll have to go over that in a moment because Koro is still getting poked out a little bit. I don't think Go-Going has enough damage to finish him up, but it will be enough to chase him back to tower. Meanwhile, the mid lane, Kool continues to really get the better of Yu.
That said, Yu is incredibly safe right now using the Zillion, although Drug doesn't connect. Okay. Using the Zillion passive, of course, he gets the global experience. Got level 6 before Kool, so he has the corner shift available. So the fear in that lane is pretty much completely alleviated. In the top lane, Go-Going did try to use a sneaky teleport to get the advantage on Koro. Unfortunately, his cooldowns did not pan out for him, wasn't able to pick up the kill there. And that's frankly a teleport down, so hopefully he can, yeah, see, and look, Koro is actually just going to walk back into the lane. So we'll see if EDG do anything with this TP advantage and maybe look to pressure a early dragon objective.
Yeah, and that would really be helpful for them for securing that early game lead that they don't always try to get. They try to hold out, but if they can get a little bit early game, they can definitely kind of just hold that until they get to the late game when they have a really good scaling comp anyways.
Definitely, but again, it's all about using the knowledge that we have. And I'd like to see EDG make a power play here, but I mean, they have the Chrono Shift available. I think they definitely need to wait on the power spike of the Evelyn ult.
They're playing incredibly passive. It is just kind of their MO.
EDG.
Yeah, and I think that they're unsure of what to make of this bot lane aggression in particular. I think the Lucian pick, frankly, surprised them. Even though Sahn has been playing it, it seemed like it should be a super hotly contested thing.
Well, he picks it to amend his weak laning presence.
Yeah, that's a fair point. Okay, so now Kool making a roam just to clear out a ward right now. This could set up a fight if Clear Love wants to go in and try to make the collapse happen with you, but again, they're playing extremely passive now. They see Drug around the side, so they won't want to take it. I feel like this game is definitely going to get to that point where the laning phase is extended, is elongated, and we have a very late first blood.
And that's pretty signature from EDG. They like to extend that laning phase. Again, when they do something, they do it all together, so the longer that they can stay and kind of farm up their power, they like that, the better for them. Very curious kind of the different of play styles though between Zillion. Again, you talked about Zitai, how he was kind of the OG of the Zillion pick. The idea was the Chinese love to tower dive, that you would immediately get level 6 and then you use your mobility and you'd speed up, you'd run down into, you know, the bottom or the top tower and you'd immediately tower dive and use that ultimate. But Hold on a second.
Oh.
Looks like we got something sneaky happening in the mid lane. No, I think
he's doing things
off.
Together. No, yeah, he's Cool's playing very, very safe on this. But the fact that he's been able to outfarm as well.
Again, kind of playing to use MO. He's effectively playing Zillion-like Ziggs right now. Staying in the mid lane, just clearing waves.
Yeah, and there's really no reason not to do that. Of course, you may not necessarily win against Cool, but you don't need to win against Cool. All you need to do is stall him out and not let him roam. So far, so good. Now, he is making
mission
a few moves. Yeah. Dragon might be in the sights of OMG, but they are being pinged out right now. There is a ward on this one. They are completely unaware as they will start this two-man Dragon attempt. But already, see you, Clear Love, and friends moving around to the side. Dada joins the party. This Dragon is going low, but there's a teleport going on right now. Koro coming in, and they back away immediately, but Dada, it might be too late for him. Oh, Twisted Advance, he's in trouble, and that is going to be First Blood going over to FCZF. And now, EDG to go ahead for the Dragon.
And of course, the big issue though there is that OMG challenged a Dragon without having the numbers advantage. We talked about how the teleport was down for Gogoing. Coral made the correct play. He just walked away from the aggressive cow, walked back into lane, and was able to teleport there, pick up First Blood, the lead, and the Dragon.
Yeah, and all that, a lot of it capitalized on Gogoing not quite having his teleport up yet anyways, so they had a strict numbers advantage. This was EDG recognizing that they had the ability to do that. OMG can't continue to make mistakes like that. They looked like they were doing well to begin with, but it just all fell apart.
I mean, and frankly, losing the early game to a team like EDG, I mean, they're almost the Samsung Blue, if you will, of China. Again, it's all about that late game team 5v5 presence, and this is not where you want to be, but in the mid lane.
Yu's going to get popped, but it is his ult going off. Dragon Cool will try to finish him off, but can he get back? Instantly flashed, and that will be a Zillion staying alive. Gogoing and Koro continue to trade out. Gogoing is perfectly okay to take this, but he's a little bit low on mana, and he was on the wrong side of a few minions. Koro now actually out-bullying him. It's strange. We've seen this complete reversal in the 1v1 situation.
Well, it's like we talked about in Champions, like the different kind of MO of the top laners coming to play again. This
Freaky
is,
Friday, isn't it?
I know, right? This is much more Koro style, and of course, Gogoing just trying to pick up the pseudo-counter, the pseudo-Maokai, if you will, and Alistar. Look at the item disadvantage across the board. Catalyst boots versus Ruby Doran's boots. So Gogoing not having the best time. See, once he gets those items, how it'll work out for him. But in the bot lane, Clear Love again. Hanging around, looking for the ganks.
This makes sense. I mean, this is your all-star AD carry and support. You definitely want to get them into the lead. They're normally winning their lane anyways, but if not, well, might as well take a few trips down there and see if I can alleviate some of the pressure. But Son and Dada are giving them quite a lot of trouble. Oh, there's the flash soul shackles. Can they get Dada again? He has had trouble with getting caught up, but they focus him hard now, and he is going low. FCZF better be careful. Son, he's going to make a move, but he doesn't have enough damage to finish it off. Another kill on the Dada 7.
And FCCF showing the proficiency of his Morgana, a perfectly timed Black Shield to dodge the Nami Tidal Wave to make sure that Dark Binding connected to secure the kill. A lot of flashes burned for that, so we'll see if maybe Drug is able to kind of counter gank in the next few minutes and take advantage of that, but otherwise, great play by EDG.
And they're recognizing the weak link and just systematically dismantling it every single time. Again, Dada has not had much success on champions that, when caught out, are easily bursted down. Sure, it shifts the focus to him and not to Son, but Son's on a very mobile carry anyways. It seems like this is a bit mismatched, and they frankly were just kind of picked out. They didn't get what they wanted to in that bot lane in particular.
Well, OMG is one of the few teams that you can tell that methodically they're going in with a playstyle and a plan and trying to implement it. Again, starting the top jungle, allowing Son to get early lane presence, using a very old school kind of OGN esque lane presence, you know, the Nami E on top of the Lucian double tap. I mean, it's a very powerful poking lane tool. Issue with Lucian though is, I think, what, played 11 times since
his
4.14 is the patch that we're on. Played 11 times since the 4.13 patch and has only won 3 of those games.
Yeah, it's not a very good win rate despite the fact that he's continued to be a top pick in the LPL. A bit curious of a statistic nonetheless. Up in the top lane, Gogoing and Koro are going to just trade a little bit more damage. These guys will be at it for days. I think we've seen some like really crazy 1v1 duels that last all game. We saw like one with World Elite where Saomei kind of just like followed the other top laner around, and like wherever they were just beating on each other. It's kind of the same thing. Gogoing, that cow holds a grudge, man.
He does. He also holds a catalyst.
Yeah, and he did get that up.
I'm sure if that's going to be a Roa or...
I think that's kind of hard to say, to be honest with you, but we'll see what happens, because they keep duking it out right now, and actually nearly getting a little bit of action from Drug. And by the way, Drug, he hasn't actually provided a whole lot of pressure this game. Really just his one main move has been to try and secure up that dragon that failed.
Which, very unlike Drug, kind of the Drug versus Clear Love,
again,
love
it's,
story.
It's complete backwards. Oh boy, San is in a lot of trouble, and he goes down. Clear Love getting himself his second kill of the game, and they will gang up big time on the roam from you to get another pick, this time onto the AD carry.
And
wow.
And unfortunately, Drug isn't in position to counter at all for anything, moving into that mid lane just to pick up a free wave, but I mean, top wasn't available to him.
Yeah. OMG, I haven't really been able to get much of anything off of what has happened to them. They don't seem 100% together. We always talk about how they rally in game 2. The problem is if they lose this game, Frost, they are on the edge of completely getting knocked out.
See if they can pull it back. Definitely still plenty of time for them in this game.
It's not as bad as it looks, definitely. 3 kills to none is not the greatest differential. It's only about a 2.4k gold lead. I mean, it doesn't mean as much, but EG is that later game team. They have that later game comp. They're going to have to start leaning incredibly uncool, but
here comes
Clear Love. And they know it. Oh, he knows it. He knows. He's going to go right on in for it, actually. Oh boy. Clear Love taking a few tower shots. Going says, I will take you, 1v2. Boy, does he ever, chasing him off his tower.
So, obviously, a mechanical misstep from EDG right there. They meant for Koro to grab the tower aggro when he twisted advance in, but unfortunately, the hate spikes tagged Going beforehand, and Clear Love took the aggro, had to back off. So, Going gets out with his life. Very lucky cow.
Oh yeah, and he's been able to do so much with so little, having so much trouble. He's kept up in farm in the back now, but of course, there's a few things going on in this mid lane. We actually have Drug backing. He really hasn't provided a whole lot of pressure just about anywhere. Still sitting on no boots even.
From here, Going should go straight to Dragon.
That's not a bad call. He's got his teleport up if he needs to get back in lane. It's up. They are going to be able to fight over it, and if nothing else, they can force the teleport out of core.
Okay, there he goes. I was going to say, looked like he was looking at the top lane, but no, he has decided, yes, going for that dragon. Dragon is live right now. Both teams do have the timer, of course. First dragon went over to EDG because of a miscommunication with teleport cooldown from OMG there. See if maybe OMG can kind of sneak back into this.
Yeah, however, Clear Love is already here, and they're pinging this out. They know where Drug is. EDG just seems to be one step ahead. They're making their move this way. This will be a fight if they want to take it. And to be honest, right now, OMG's not really fighting that well. Drug is in trouble. Oh my goodness, that was a big dark bind resulting in a lot of damage. Name dishing out a lot more than he's taking down. And this dragon immediately started down by EDG, betting that Drug won't want to go in for the smite steal. And they might be right. Oh, they might be wrong, though. That's a teleport in tidal wave. It's going to go down, however. Fight is going to be on FCZF. He's going to get burst down, but not really because the Zillion ult comes down on him just in time. It will still be a very bad fight. Drug is going to be the first casualty. Koro in the middle of it all. They're flashing and dodging as best they can, but OMG cannot string enough damage together for a kill. Koro, he's low. They're focusing him, but that might not be the right target. Colin comes out, but that's going to be a kill picked up by Name. EDG coming up absolutely perfect. Dragon, 2 kills. Clear lead in this game.
The only thing that I was kind of curious was the back end teleport from Koro right there. He could have easily backed, healed, bought from the dragon as well as the assist that he picked up from that kill, and then walked up to the top lane. Obviously, he saw that Going had already expended his teleport, but it looks like he's trying to reset that wave there, so might have been really close to an item and just wanted that extra boost of gold to go through.
Yeah, doing that in the heat of battle, it's kind of hard to really say what the best decision is when you've got literally seconds to make it. Now, you called a few items correctly, I want to point out, though. The Rod of Age is completed for both top laners. Definitely a curious choice, but who are we to question Going, I suppose?
It's not the most popular Alistar top build, if you will.
No, but this is a very particular Alistar top. I feel like he definitely has had very mixed success versus...
It's not his playstyle.
Yeah, it's definitely not. It's really strange. He went for the counter pick. I feel like OMG really just needs to fall back on something that they're comfortable with. It seems to win them games so many more times.
And effectively what happened in that last team fight on the dragon was just the viability and the usefulness of Maokai, even in the 4.14 patch, how much safety and superficial tankiness that he offers his team with his ultimate, even with the changes of the 10-second cap added to it, compared to how OMG was able to utilize Alistar combo correctly, which frankly didn't go down right.
Yeah, I think he's still trying to play it very hard carry style, and it just doesn't have enough damage. Yeah, I just got a really weird visual of like Alistar like running around like trying to blade surge into things with like the armor, the Aurelia armor.
Just think of his W as the blade surge.
Ah, except it doesn't reset nearly as quickly. nonetheless, it's definitely a bit of a mismatch in styles, and I think they're not really quite doing it. Oh, Claire Love going forward onto Cool. He gets out in time. That trick might work on other laners, but boys, you'll have to try a little harder than that if you want to take down Cool. Meanwhile, the top lane tower is nearly done, but Going might have to give his tower up. Going to be the first one taken by EDG. Well, by Caster Minion.
EDG being very aggressive, and this is what we were talking about, of kind of the evolution of the vision denial game that particularly EDG and LGD have started to really play.
Oh yeah, definitely big ups to them as they've kind of evolved this a little bit. OMG seemed to be on the back, but we talked about them being sort of the leading strategists of this league, and they seem to have fallen a little bit behind, especially in this game. Picks definitely didn't go their way. I think we can safely say that at this point. But nonetheless, they still have a path back into this game. The issue is they need to start forcing action to happen because EDG gets stronger every minute.
Definitely true.
Time's running out.
Okay, there we go. It's like the blue buff has to be spawning. There's no reason for EG to invest as much gold as they have.
You know,
there.
We have gotten some weird spectator glitches with the blue buff sometimes. All the buffs, really. You know, where they sit on there all game. Meanwhile, this is our jungle now. Come back another time. It's gonna go down. Another one picked up for Clear Love, and
of course, what that was is investing their wards. So the early dragon that they got, they turned that gold into vision money. They turned that vision money into the blue buff, denying Syndra.
Why not? When the stock's doing well, just keep putting money into it and working out. And that stock's named Clear Love right now, actually. 2-0-2, he has a phenomenal kill participation rate. We always talk about how that is one of the highest, and might have a little bit more in just a minute. Drug is in trouble. Can Clear Love get that one? Oh my goodness, Name getting a tower in all of it as well. Yeah, so another kill picked up by Clear Love. Pretty massive this game. They're going to try to ride that wave. And speaking of waves, not going to be enough to save this tower if they choose to push on it. Now Korra moving towards the bottom. Pool is going to maybe get caught out here. Oh, he's low. I don't know if he can get out in time. Scatter the Weak is going to be able to save him, but he blows up. Big bomb in his head, and Yu grabs himself his second kill of the game.
And with that, they're going to swing mid and use that pressure. So make a pick into the jungle again. They have complete vision control of that. That's lit up like a Christmas tree. And they should take two global objectives.
And they're five
mana. Exactly, and the blue buff in one fell swoop. And again, EDG, when they do something, they do it together.
Yeah, and it's really showing why they do that. It is just an unstoppable five-man gank squad, and the switch flipped. They decided, okay, guys, we're ahead enough. We're going to be able to do things. They've given up one tower for all of that. It is a perfect game for kills. They have not gone down yet, and the spread of gold is actually very nice.
The issue is that OMG, they're a skirmish-based team. We talk about all the time the Bash Brothers between Cool, Drug, and Going. And they picked a team. Yes, you have a lot of pick composition right there, but Drug and Cool never really found their synergy or utilized their champions correctly. It benefits them entirely to play a 3v3, a 2v2, 3v2 kind of style. Uh-oh.
Well, if they can't, a numbers
advantage.
Speaking
of pick, though.
Uh-oh, hello. Well, I heard of Fnatic brushes. This is a little bit ridiculous. Oh, boy.
They got the pink ward, though.
Yeah. No, I mean, that's worth it, right? Total 30 gold in your pocket. I'll buy you a sweet potion back home.
Nice. That's what, 150 health?
Oh, yeah.
Don't
that means
it.
A lot. No, I'm being totally serious.
Don't
what are you
knock
talking
it
about?
Till you try
so
it.
OMG is definitely realizing they have to make this play now. So they're sending four members of their own to take out this damage turret, but there's a teleport in. Uh-oh, this could be trouble. FCZF getting a four-man shackles on Cool's low. I don't think they're going to save his life. That's going to be lights out. Clear Love taking himself another one. 4-0-2, and now Dada looking to add to that one. Another pickup. It's a double kill for Evelynn. Sans low. They might just give it to Clear Love. It's going to be Coral, though. And this could be Baron. It's 21-22 now minutes. I think it's Baron time, Frost.
That was the slowest moving flank. Did you watch that tree walk across from the teleport just in a straight line?
It was an iceberg.
I know.
Every year it gets a little bit closer. And
OMG
completely off kilter after that one. Just surrender the game at 22 minutes. Guys, give up. Let's go for number two. I didn't see that one coming.
Wow. A 22-minute surrender in the finals.
Yeah, that I think speaks volumes about the attitude. I don't know if OMG are just mentally defeated or they're just like, all right, abandon this game.
Well,
let's go into number two. Let's not even play it out because we don't want that on our minds.
The mentality of China is that if you're talking about the next game, then there's no reason to stay in the current one. Surrenders are much more common in LPL than the surrounding regions. Again, it's like you said, the mentality, the not wanting to be self-defeated, just, okay, if we're talking about the next game, just move on, get to that next game, get it started. Mm-hmm. That said, though, this is game, set, and match for EDG.
Yeah, with one game lead already in their pockets, and now a second one added to that. OMG, if they want to do the turnaround that they are known for, they have to do it here and now. If they can take it all the way to the fifth game, that'd be something, but they're going to have a huge uphill battle to do it, especially after those results?
The biggest issue, again, was OMG is a skirmish-based team. They're a very fast-paced, early aggression, a great synergy. OMG either completely falls apart or they're firing on all cylinders. It's one or the other, and it's always been a consistency issue as far as these top Chinese teams. And right now, EDG is just getting the game that they want every single time. Those were all comfort picks.
Well, and not only that, they you know, we talk about how they like to go to the late game especially, but they kind of got there early. They were able to just outplay in lane, even if they were being pressured in, like, very odd places. The bot lane, Sahn going a little bit more aggressive. They found a couple of picks. They got Clearlove massive. He got most of the kills that game. His KDA was off the charts. And then they were like, well, it's 22 minutes and we just took out three of them. Why don't we just Baron? And that was just too much for OMG to handle.
But OMG, of course, recognizing that everything had lined up. So, again, changing the mentality, changing the strategy of what they want to go into this. Maokai pick. OMG, of course, time will have first pick. So could leave that one open, try to get that onto Gogoing. But again, we keep talking about that isn't necessarily Gogoing's play style. He likes the Aurelia. He likes the Kayle. He likes the Jax. He likes to be the star, the center of attention, the carry. Maokai does have that potential still on his kit, but... again, that's a huge pick for Koro.
I think they have to ban it. Absolutely. They focus kind of the wrong things. Well, we'll see what if they can do. I mean, we definitely expect huge changes from OMG game over game. We'll see if the Kings of Adaptation can do it again. But this is match point. Will EDG take it? Will they get their ticket to Worlds? We'll have to find out, guys. We're going to go to a brief break, but when we return, we'll get to that next game. You are watching the LPL in English. Don't go anywhere.